Chris Ashton ever built became an internet legend. If ever there was a love-hate relationship with a car, you're about to have one. His 1970 Mustang breaks all the rules and plays by some new ones. Chris, your car is amazing. I cannot even believe that I'm here right now.
Thanks.
Well, obviously this thing has been seen on the internet, and there have been people that have done videos on it, and your Instagram blew up
right. Because
of this car. But yeah. It's literally the first car you ever built.
It was the beginning of everything, I guess. I modded cars. My first car I got before I had a license, and I worked on it in the backyard until I could drive. And then, so from that point on, I've been working on cars, but this was the first one that I ever completely tore down to nothing and then rebuilt the whole thing.
And it's significant to me because you didn't work in an automotive shop and you weren't even working in the automotive industry. Tell us what you did, or still do, I guess.
I still do, yeah. I work on computer games. That's been my career for the last 25 years.
And your degree is in
graphic design mm-hmm. and illustration.
Okay.
And so the schooling led me to doing art and video games. And then video games, just that's a nice career. But I also grew up, I loved cars. I always had Hot Wheels, and you know, my dad was a car salesman when I was growing up, and he's kind of a gearhead as well. So when I went into college, I remember on the freshman seminar day, they ask you like, what do you want to do? Which is such a scary thing anyway,
right,
when you're a kid, trying to figure out what am I going to do with my life. I wanted to design cars, but they didn't have any courses like that. But they did have courses on the computer, and so I went into illustration. So yeah, I was in my 40s and got this thing built, and it went so well. But I wound up getting invited to go to be in Toyo's booth at SEMA, which was a surprise, and then the car just exploded on the internet and everything, and so it kind of took off.
And you have a massive following on Instagram.
Right.
You've had, what, celebrities try and offer to buy this
car?
I mean, this car is putting you on the map and making you think, like you said, if I'm ever going to do something different, surely I can make a career of this.
Right? Yep. So, well, I was still unsure. Then I built my second car, the GT40. And that one was kind of like, am I still that inspired? Am I still that excited about it? Is it just sort of a phase, or, you know, and it's just, I just got even more into it.
So you built this in a little garage,
a two-car garage. Yeah.
And here we are in the brand new Ruffian Cars shop.
Mm-hmm.
And
I have three employees, and
that's crazy.
So yeah, starting over from the very beginnings. Yeah.
Are you going to spec build your next cars, or do you have clients
already?
No,
so the thought was maybe we can just build cars that we're passionate about and we're excited about, and then sell them.
Yeah.
It's not the norm, but you know, I hired people that are really passionate about building cars. They all have their own car projects, which was part of the thing I was looking for.
Yeah.
You know, I want them to help make these even better than I can do on my own.
Well, my brain is going 1,000 miles an hour because the GT40 sitting over there, I mean, this is such an eclectic, crazy collection.
Right.
I want to talk about this car.
Mm-hmm. I loved muscle cars growing up. And the thought was build a TransAm car for the street that I could drive around town. And so I built this to those specs. And then I also found internet forums where guys own the real cars and they race them, vintage racing and stuff, and they were so awesome. Like, they talked to me, answered my questions and stuff. It's still carbureted, you know. I could have run fuel injection on it, but it would have gone away from the TransAm mm-hmm. experience, right? Everything
right.
needs to be manual, and you need to feel, you know, nothing computer or that sort of thing.
And you've been autocrossing for couple of decades now, right?
Yeah, I built this to autocross because that's the thing that I do. So it's not really a big track car. It's a low speed, high grip, lots of fast steering. You know,
you're pretty much in first, second gear the whole time, and that's it.
Second gear usually, yeah. You shift out of first first turn, and then mm-hmm. the whole thing's in second gear. So it also made sense. It's a 427 cubic inch motor, right? So it makes a lot of torque.
Take me straight to this LS3, a totally Did you guys hear that? This is not conventional choice for a Mustang.
Yeah, I, well, one, I was on a budget. And then two, I wanted it to be as fast as it could be for as cheap as it could be, right? So it's an LS3, and it's aluminum block, okay. So it's light. It's still a cam in block, so it's kind of old school design. I know it's a newer motor, but it's still old school design, right? Which I had to do in order to fit it in between the shock towers. Motor sits lower, farther back than it did when it was stock.
Okay.
So I need sort of big block cubes, but I don't want big block weight in the front of the car because it would just push,
right.
It would plow,
right?
So like the car looks really cool, but it's built for functionality, like 100%. It has fender flares. Yes, the fender flares look cool, but the fender flares allow me to run big fat tires, which is important for autocrossing. So,
Tell me about your carb setup.
So I had just a normal 850 Holley that was on there, and it's just a real standard scenario. But I had problems with it stalling whenever I would brake really hard. So this is a quick fuel carburetor. It's an annular style.
Right.
It likes it, and I can brake as hard as I want. It doesn't stall,
and it's a lot quicker throttle response. This just atomizes better,
right.
And it just delivers that fuel faster.
Yeah, so the annular Venturis, they push fuel out in sort of all around a circle instead of one point.
So your fenders are so sick.
Thanks. Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, these are steel, and you did these yourself.
Right, and I had to learn how to use the planishing hammer and the English wheel to do those. So the fenders, the front spoiler, the vents, all this stuff, it's all steel body.
I don't instinctively know that you raked this a little bit, but show me what you did.
If we take a pie slice from here, you think of Pac-Man's mouth.
Right, okay.
So a pie slice from up here.
Yes.
Down to here.
Yes.
And at the end of that pie slice here, it's over an inch.
Okay.
And then I cut it all the way across here. And then the whole thing bends down an inch.
I see.
So if you look at a side profile of a 1970 Mustang, the front fender, the body line, it's almost perfectly straight across.
Okay.
And then if you look at my car, the side profile, or the old TransAm race cars, this is where they were cheating. Because the nose bends down, so you got less wind resistance. Once the car's assembled, you have no idea.
Yeah.
But it's there, it makes a difference.
What did you do there? Are those stickers, those murals?
No, I painted it.
Like, no big deal, I just design video games, cars, I paint murals.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, people come over and they ask about it, and then they get so surprised, and I'm almost like half offended. I'm like, well, I built this whole thing, and you're impressed by that mural, like, but what about this?
Okay, so you've got your fuel cell. How much?
Yeah.
How many gallons is this?
A 20-gallon fuel cell.
Okay.
So it's pretty big. Factory fuel tank was 16 gallons, so this is bigger than factory. But, you know, the race cars, they were doing long-distance races, so they had bigger fuel capacities.
So tell me what you've got going on right here.
So this is the Watts link.
Okay.
So part of one end is connected to the rear axle.
Yep.
And then it goes through this pivot that's in the center.
Okay.
And that pivot's mounted to the chassis. And then the other arm goes to the other part of the axle. So it's mounted to the chassis in the middle. And then these arms, one's high, one's low. Because this pivot, as the rear axle goes up and down, this turnbuckle, it pivots. The idea is that the rear axle goes up and down very straight. As opposed to a panhard bar, it has a radius to it.
Right. What kind of gear and axle do you have going on?
So it's just a Ford 9-inch housing. The third member is out of a NASCAR takeoff. So it's got a big Daytona.
He's not messing around.
Daytona bearing and extra oil channels and stuff in there. But it's a 4:11:1 ratio in the rear and a Torsen differentials.
Okay, so here's your exhaust.
Right. So I actually run in mufflers for the street, but I want to be able to bypass the mufflers when I'm racing.
Your six-speed transmission.
Yes. It's a T56 Super Magnum out of a newer Camaro SS.
So your front suspension.
Yeah, it's the same design, basic design, as what Ford did. But if you notice, like, these end links and stuff, it's all heim jointed. Mm-hmm. There's no rubber bushings anywhere in the suspension, front or rear. It's all heim jointed. The suspension is doing exactly what it's supposed to do. The shocks are absorbing. It's not like rubber bushings are doing the absorbing, right? You want the parts designed to do the work, to do the work. So back in the day, Shelby did it. What they did, what they call a Shelby drop, right, where they lowered the control arms an inch. And then that just gave you more negative camber when you were in a corner. Because the upper control arms, basically, you've tilted them down. So then when the suspension goes up, they're pulling in because of the radius. If you've like watched the movie Bullet, right, and you see the car going around the corner, it's like the wheel's tucking under the car.
Yeah.
Right? We want the wheel to actually flex outwards, so that the tire stays flat on the pavement. So the Shelby drop is part of that. So like, when they were running TransAm, they were running like 3 degrees of negative camber. Hmm. But on this, I'm running like 1.5.
Okay. So the Shelby drop is kind of one of those, the least expensive upgrades. If you had a stock Mustang that you can do to improve that handling.
You can buy or even just download templates and cut.
It doesn't cost anything, right? You're just drilling four holes and lowering. Like
literally marking new holes, drilling them, and then changing the bolts.
So, did you build these?
Yeah, so this is all part of the bodywork that I built. This is the front spoiler, and it's just, you're trying to keep air out from under the car, so it's built in steel. And actually, you can see these blocks here. Mm-hmm. You can tell that I added those, and that's part of the 1-inch drop that happened above. It trickles down to everything, the bumper mounts, the headlight mounts, the front valence, everything had to be dropped down an inch in order to bolt it all back together.
Like a can of worms.
It was definitely I knew about it, right? And I knew what they did, but I didn't know, nobody has a list of like, here's all the things you're gonna have to do.
You're gonna go down that path and you're gonna commit when you start doing that.
Yeah, exactly.
Just a little cotter pin. Oh, got it. Okay, hold on. Oh my gosh! His hips are smaller than mine! Hold on, I got this. All right, got it. So just give it a tug. Oh! Okay. Isn't this kind of a Dodge thing?
It is.
What the heck?
It is, but it's super cool.
Everybody's gonna get over it. They're gonna get over it.
Yeah.
Okay, so your AccuSump, is that because of the changes going back and forth?
Tires like these, you're gonna get so much lateral grip that even though we have a baffled oil pan with oil trap in it, if you corner for too long, that oil can push away from the pickup. So if you lose oil pressure, this is 2 quarts of oil that can be pushed into the system, but this is the old school way of doing it.
Look at this. They sell like fancy, you know, label makers, but you had to get the kind, the old school with the wheel and pinch it.
Instead of mileage on race cars, you check hours on race cars. So we've got 66 hours on the car of actual like runtime.
Wow. Has anybody ever driven this before?
So I've had a couple friends, couple friends drove the car on the street. No one else has ever raced it. So you gotta be the first one to drive it in anger.
In anger?
Yeah.
Dude, when I am angry, I actually do drive better. There's so much to look at. You changed your wheels. These are These are your racing setup.
Yeah, wheels, this is for race day tomorrow. Yeah.
These are racing.
As fast as this car is gonna get. Like Hoosier slicks autocrossing tires are no joke. These are 11s up front. These are 315s. And you can see how much the Hoosiers are really wide. They fit past the lip of the tire. So, and then in the rear, we're running 345s, and those are 13-inch rims back there. These are Wilwood brakes, front and rear. But if we put even bigger brakes on here, it would just be extra weight.
Yeah.
You know, unsprung weight on the front of the car. So I didn't want that. So these are you know, more than what we need really for autocrossing. It's got a G-force meter inside of the car, and so an accelerometer. Mm-hmm. It monitors the throttle, it monitors the brakes, it knows what you're doing on the car.
You can stiffen it where you, it automatically is stiffening and softening.
Right, so when we autocross and you go left, right through the slaloms, the G-force meter senses that and then it stiffens the outside shocks.
Do you know how intimidated I am by this whole process?
I can't. Listen, I can't imagine somebody
I've driven a lot of things.
Right?
Right?
Yes.
But this is, remember, this show is called Detour, mm-hmm. and I'm going to do things that are different.
Right.
Detour from what I normally do.
Yeah.
But I have to admit that this is a very intimidating car.
Really well in the first half.
And then lose
And then it's like you start to get really excited and you just start to go for it and you overcook everything. Just smooth it out, just relax a little bit.
Okay.
And a lot of times slower is faster out here.
Okay. Well, and just understanding how much power this has and what the brakes feel like, there's a whole learning curve. Okay, no cones, Nicole. Okay, slow is fast.
Thank you. so you can feel really good about that. Woo! Good. My word. There we go.
Chris Ashton, this autocross experience was awesome. I can't believe that you actually let me come out here and drive the Ruffian Mustang.
Yeah.
I was honored. How did I do?
It was my honor. It was super cool to see somebody throw my car around, and I think you did amazing. You can drive any of my stuff anytime.
Well, thank you. You know what? It's really about setting your own goals and being the best you can be every single time. Let me know how you guys think I did today. Chris Ashton, Ruffian Cars. Like and subscribe, and we will catch you guys next time.
This show is a ton of hours to produce, and we could use your support. Go to patreon.com/NicoleJohnsonsDetour or check out our merchandise, NicoleJohnsonsDetour.com.
Ready? 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 This place is so cool, and we're gonna do this again. I'm not doing this. I'm not.
Your steering wheel's upside down, bro.
Remind me to stand up. Sometimes I slouch. Okay, because I'm so... Can we please go drive this car?
You bet. Easy.
Did you know that they say that if you can hang for at least a minute, it's really good for you as you get older? No, I'm not ready now. See? Just when you think I'm ready.